geological map, as you see, a colorful sheet and very interesting, a whole new world of features and whole new world of information, so much information that sometimes it is it's just like a book for the field that you have been, just like you produce a field report and then you produce a geological map. Geological map equally weighs and describes whatever you have done. Like, for example, whatever part you have done is already explained in the report, but if you have not shown it in the geological map, then the report is meaningless. Any good fieldwork results in the formation of a brilliant and sometimes very great maps. And maps are not only for mining companies, for oil and gas sector, but maps are also very important for solving some of the controversies. Like, there was a controversy of age of the formation in Pakistan, and there was a geologist, his name was Dr. G. He spent 20 years in producing maps, and as a result of that map, he solved a controversy of the age of salt formation. That was a big debate in the 20th century. Okay, we were discussing about the various parts, and it is very important for you, being geologist and being a professional geologist in future. And for that purpose, you need to know the various parts of geological map. As we said, this is the central part, is mostly the map itself, as you guys can see here. Then on the right side, you have the key. All the symbols are described here on the right hand side. And then on the left hand side, you can see the lithostratigraphy column. Lithostratigraphy column is nothing else than the vertical relationship of rocks. You can see here various colors and various formations. They just show the generalized stratigraphy column in order to represent that how the faces look like, or how the rocks and the group of rocks look like vertically. Then if you want to give any supplementary information, if there is any information that is not given in the map and you think it is useful, you can just put it in this corner. Then you need to represent the scale, like numeric scale or graphical scale. Scale is actually, you can consider it something like that. You want to make a scale of city of Sargodha, or maybe University of Sargodha. If you want to represent University of Sargodha or city of Sargodha on a sheet of map, then you cannot have a sheet of 2 kilometers, right? We need to have a scale. In that scale, you need to define, okay, 1 centimeter on this map is equal to 1 kilometer on ground. But anything that is present on the ground will be converted into a feature in the map. Then here comes the title, whatever title you have for the map, like geological map of Sargodha region, or geological map of salt range, or geological map of Margulla hills, or geological map of Hazara region, so and so on. Then here comes important part, those guys who worked in the field and who have spent hours and hours, and sometimes some geologists, the geological camps, they go for each summer previously, and in that summer they used to map a particular area for a particular time. And after years and years of efforts, they come up with some maps, and as a result of those maps, they solved many major issues that existed at that time in terms of tectonics, like professors from University of the Punjab, they spent 20 years to solve a mystery and solve a boundary between the main boundary that was within existed within the Indian plate, and they spent like 20 years in marking that boundary. We call it as an MCT now. Okay, you can see now here another example of how various features are distributed within the map. And you can see here the index map, index of this map, like where this map is located on the regional or global scale. Okay, this is the example of the title. You just write the title, like whatever region it is, and what is the name of the country. And here we have the explanation in terms of the legend. And in legend, you can see we have QQQ. Q is actually for quaternary. If you have quaternary deposits, you use Q. Similarly, tertiary, we can use T. So the symbol sometimes can be self-descriptive. And it is very important that you have a uniform symbol system and uniform legends. Similarly, you can see here the name of the person who made the map. Again, the title of the map. Maybe the name of the institution, the geological survey. All these things can come in the top. The type of the map compiled by, and maybe the name of the map sheet that comes here. So you can have all the information that you think will be useful after you produce this geological map. In the left hand side, you need to follow the international standards. You can also name the authors, co-authors, and sometimes there are more than 50 persons who are professionals or geologists who contribute to a single sheet of paper. And you can see how much hard work and how much effort is needed. Like when we were doing our MSc from the University of the Punjab, we spent like 1 month in the field mapping, and then 3 to 4 months in producing the digital version of the map. And after that, you can use that map for your thesis and so and so. So you can see it here. It is the map of Ethiopia. Ethiopia is a country in Eastern Africa. And the scale is 1 into 50,000. It means anything that is 1 inch on the map represents 50,000 inch on the ground. Why we use this scale? Because it is very difficult to plot everything on the map. That's why we have different scales for different type of maps. Similarly, we can have more information on the right hand side, the coordinate system, the whatever abbreviation you used, the ministry or the agency that holds the copyright. Like for example, you cannot just copy and paste without proper acknowledgement. That will be called as plagiarism, or will be an offense under the copyright law. That's why you have to follow the coordinate system that has been described by the ministry, and you have to take proper you have to make a payment to the company or to the agency, and then they can you can ask them to allow you and give you permission. And after you get permission, then you can use that map for your studies or for your purpose, whatever your purpose is. It means it is the property of the ministry. And as it is the property of the ministry, they hold the copyright, and you need to tell them what is your purpose of asking this sheet. You have to request them. and if they allow you, then you can use it. There are different type of scales that you can see here in the map. You can see here the scale is 1:24,000. That is a numeric scale. Remember, there are always two types of scale. And there is another scale that is a graphical or that has been drawn to the scale. And you can see it here, that 1:1 mile. You just take the measurement of this with your ruler or your scale and just see how many centimeters or how many millimeters are there. Similarly, we also have kilometers, like if you are in different part of the world, like United States or the European side, they use different scales. That's why normally they put both of them, and sometimes they also give the magnetic declination information on the map. That's how it is done. Similarly, another important thing is the contour interval. It is mentioned that 40 feet. It means every line is 40 feet higher than the previous one. Okay. Sometimes people use 100 feet. Sometimes people they use 50 feet, maybe 20 feet. It depends. Whatever your purpose is for the topographic map. Okay. Then we have the grid system. We have the worldwide grid system that was established in the 1984. We call it WGS-84. And you can see the numbers are here, 15 degree and 10 seconds. Similarly, we can also have the local grid, that is the local set of measurements. You can see it here. So you can see two types of scales that are present on this. Then comes the position of map sheet in the state topographic map. As I explained it earlier, we just divide the whole region or whole area into number of sheets and then sub sheets, and then you need to see, okay, this is the map of the country, and then this is the map of the province, and then maybe this is the map of districts, and in that district this is the location of your map. It is always good that you need to mention the location, and it is also available on the topographic sheet. So you don't need to worry, you just need to redraw it from the topographic sheet that you used earlier for doing the map. And it's normally present on the lower right hand corner of your sheet. You can also notice something here, that is 1:2500, and that is 1:50,000. It means this is a scale that covers larger area, like the cover the whole country. But you can see that the details, like if you consider this thing, it will be must be a very thin line here. It means if you increase the 1:50,000 to 2500, it means the details will be less, and that will be more, it will cover more area. That's why scale is important and understanding scale is vital. Similarly, a scale of 1:50,000 will represent more information, however it will cover less area. Or each scale of the map scale, it has its own benefits and its own drawbacks. Similarly, you can have additional information, and also like you can see different colors that are present here for different units. This is the similar review of the geological mapping, and then you add various colors. You make the context based on the previous authors. You just see the names, and then based on the context you just color it differently with different formations. And here comes the important part, that is the structure geology. You just plot the faults and folds in that particular area. You can sometimes also have the magnetic anomaly map of the area, but it is optional. This is normally used for the geophysical. If you guys are interested in doing your specialization in geophysics, then this is your side of. Okay. Here comes the lithostratigraphic column. It depicts the relationship between lithostratigraphic defined units exposed in the map. You can see here we have the time scale. You guys remember we did time scale in your first semester, and now you see the application of these things, and it's more like practical part of your work now. And you can see here we have lithostratigraphic column with the age, and here you can see the lithology, and you can see that the time scale has further been divided Devonian, Carboniferous, and these Devonian and Carboniferous are further subdivided, and there has been explanation provided like how, what is the vertical relationship of these various rocks. Similarly, we have the legend. As I mentioned earlier, we have various rocks, like for example we have Carboniferous, we have Silurian, and you can see for Carboniferous we are using C. Similarly, for Pleistocene or Quaternary deposits we are using Q. So this is why making your scale and making all your arrangements to the point and make them uniform. Another important part of a geological map, if you guys see on the downside, is the geological cross section. In cross section, you just see the vertical relationship, just like you have a cake and then you cut down that cake from one side, and then you see cream and cake and chocolate and all the parts of it. Similarly, in geology, you make cross section to show the vertical relationship between rocks and what type of structural features are present there. And what does it show? It shows you the elevation above sea level, and it also shows the sum of the boreholes. If there is any oil and gas well that is located in your area, you can present it there. Similarly, some important topographic points, like if there is any hill, there is any peak in that particular area. Sometimes it is mentioned, or if it is, it comes under the line of your cross section, then you need to mention it on the map. And you can see a beautiful faulting that is present here. You see that layer, it was continuous and now it has been disturbed. Similarly, various features are present in this direction as well. So, geological map overall, it tells you the geological picture of the area, and it is presented with different colors, and different features are presented with different geometric lines. We can see the geometric and geological distribution of various features. You can see it, a feature that is present, and then there is another feature, and then there is a faulting, and so on and so on. Some of the lines that we use in the map, here we have a fault line that is present here. Inferred, we are not sure if this fault exists, so we just call it inferred and we make a dashed line. Then we have a fault. This would be a normal fault. And then we have another reverse fault or thrust fault. And similarly, if we have a nape, nape is a sheet, like a big sheet that moves from one direction to another. So this is how we use. And normally these symbols are present on the right hand side of any. Here are some additional information if you want to represent the foliation in the rocks, and if you also want to represent the strike and dip in the rock, like the bedding direction, how the bedding direction varies in different parts of it. And you can see that. Also, you can notice sometimes they put the contour lines, but they are not the dominant one. They are just the background. You can also remove them, because in the geological map, we don't use the contour lines. It is the requirement of a topography. Similarly, if you have hydrothermal alteration, or similarly, you can use various symbols and show them in the map. Or maybe ancient weathering, if there is a significant weathering feature in geomorphology, you want to show it in the map, you can also use it. Similarly, if you have very important fossil findings in the area, like you have a very good boundary between two times, like Permian to Jurassic, you just use those different boundaries and represent them with various symbols for the fossils. Maybe you have a geodynamic phenomena, where we have collusion of two plates. Also, if you have important water and mineral water springs that are present in the area, sometimes sulfur springs are also present. So you just show them on the geological map, because it is very important when you are using the geothermal energy studies and studies that are more related to the internal heat of the earth. And that comes the mining. Mining, as you know, initially we saw that the maps in the start of the human history, people used in the older times maps to find the location of the mines. You use different colors of and different set of lines and symbols to decipher various type of mines. Similarly, if you want to show boreholes, different type of boreholes, producing and non-producing, and similarly, there are different lines that you see that are cutting across your map. These are the lines of cross section. Like you see, we see a cross section here. You guys remember? And you see 1, 2. It means this has been taken from somewhere here. See, this is the one, and it represents this line on the map. Oh, it is the line of cross section, and it shows you. Okay, here comes an interesting exercise. So what you guys need to do is to do this small exercise. It is very handy, and it will help you to understand the concept of contouring. What you can do, you can just use your holidays, or whenever you have, I think you can use it and do it in half an hour, whatever time you have for free, just for fun. You can see here different points, and these different points are representing different elevations in that particular area. You see there is 311, and there is also 205. So it means these are, or maybe 339 is the highest and 205 maybe the lowest. What you need to do, you need to connect these points in the shape of contours, and you can define a contour interval of 50, 50, and then maybe you make one contour and try to pass that contour in those areas where you think it can pass. Because remember, contour represents points of equal elevation. So instructions are already given in the exercise. Once you design these lines and follow the instructions, you see two lines are already drawn in this one, and it represents the 300.